Can you hear me? Okay. Thanks, everybody, for sticking around for the annual meeting. We appear to have a quorum of council members and congressional members. So with that, I will officially call this meeting to order. And first off, I'll turn it over to Pastor Deb for devotions.
All right, let's just pray. God, we thank you for this time to gather together as a congregation to do the business of the church. And God, we just ask that this meeting go well, that we look to you for guidance and wisdom, and that we are able to be joyful, God, and to have a good time at the annual meeting as well. So God, I thank you for the business of this congregation, for those who lead it, and for those who follow. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Okay, again, we have a quorum of council members. Just for anybody that may be new, I'll just introduce real quick. Butch Rude, Adair Deers, I'm Jack Kaur. Greg Negebauer is the vice president. Marvin Bishop is our treasurer. Crystal Wiles and Emily Durkis. Oh, geez. The most important one, you just showed up. Marie Kennedy, sorry. Just so everybody knows, myself and Crystal are the council members that will be ending our term this year. So we'll start with the minutes of the last annual meeting, which I'll turn over to Adair.
The minutes of the last annual meeting are on page 4. Has everybody had an opportunity to read them? Anybody not gotten a chance to read them? Okay, it seems like everybody's read them. Are there any questions? Are there any questions about the minutes? No questions?
Okay, with that, we're looking for a motion on the floor to approve that we have a motion. Please state your name. We have a motion and a second on the floor to approve the minutes of the 2016 meeting. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion's approved. Next up is the pastor's report, Pastor Deb.
Well, if you turn to page 5, you will see my written report, and I am not going to read it to you because I'm pretty sure most of you can read. But wow, what a great year this has been for this congregation. I want you, and Jack may ask you to do it again later, but I want you to applaud for yourselves. So give yourselves a hand. This congregation rocks. As you read through this report, it is unbelievable the ministry that has happened in the last 12 months in this congregation. And remember, you were still in transition. I was not called here until March 15th. So you are a pretty amazing group of people that does a lot of amazing ministry. And I have spent quite a bit of time listening through the table talks gatherings, through council meetings and our council retreat, through individual discussions that I've had with people and family members, through discussions with the youth groups. And I listened to try to hear what it is we should focus on for 2017. Because we can't do it all. There is no congregation in the entire world that can do everything. So what is our mission? What is it that we need to focus on so that as a leader, I know where to put my time and energy, and as a congregation, we can make those decisions of where we put our time and energy and resources. So I have offered for you, and they're kind of tiny there, but they are in print. I have offered for you what I have kind of compiled and gathered from the listening that I have done basically for the past couple of years. And here is where I think I offer that we should have our focus for 2017. Some of this we're already doing, and I want to acknowledge that, and I want to continue to do it well. So that would be things like offer a solid Sunday morning worship service, that people can come and be engaged in God, be in fellowship with one another, that we can be welcoming and inviting to those who are looking for a church home. To offer a solid community Christian education opportunities, to continue with our dog night and our community VBS, which is just fantastic, and then also to increase adult education opportunities. Because I hear that from you, that you would like that as well. To engage more people in faith growth opportunities inside and outside the church. To continue to grow the community youth group. To connect with others in the community and around the area. To find new ways for people to gather together to build relationships. And that doesn't mean only on Sunday mornings inside this building. It's also to look and to continue to recognize and acknowledge those ways that we engage people out in the community, in our workplace, wherever it may be, to be in relationship with each other and to be in relationship with God, however that looks. And to practice inviting others to be a part of what is happening. We do a great job of welcoming people when they walk through our doors. But as Lutherans, as most many mainline denominations, we might struggle sometimes to actually invite others to be a part of what we're doing, and not just on Sunday mornings, but throughout the week. So we need to find ways to practice that. And to continue to explore the possibility of a second evening worship service. I don't want an evening worship service that looks just like Sunday morning. Because those of you who come on Sunday morning are engaged by what's going on, but there's a whole lot of people in this community who are not engaged by a typical Sunday morning worship service. So what does that look like if we were to offer a second worship service to those who don't have a worshiping home already? Or maybe to those who are gone on Sunday morning or working on Sunday morning? Or one family I talked to just don't have the capacity because of health reasons to be ready for worship at 9:30, but would love to worship at like 5 o'clock in the evening. I don't have an answer for you yet. I'm not saying that this is going to start tomorrow. What I'd like to do is to continue to listen, to pray about, and to look at what a second service might look like at like a 5 o'clock on a Sunday night. So, that is what I offer for focus points for 2017. I would love thoughts or comments. If anybody has any questions about what's in my report, if you strongly disagree with things that are there, if there's other things you think we should be focusing on, and if you're too shy, which I'm not sure how many of you sitting here are that shy. But if you're too shy to say something now, no, you can always call. And we'll set up a time to talk. Comments?
Well, I think you've done an excellent job with youth and children. And I think that's important to the church.
I think so, too. I think that's one of the main missions of our congregation. All right, I will turn it over to the prez.
Okay, thank you, Pastor Deb. My annual report is on page 7. It's short, but there's a lot of information in there. First of all, thank you to this congregation and to this council for not just letting me serve on council, but trusting me to be your leader. Thank you to the committees and the volunteers for all their hard work and truly out there doing God's work. And this is a congregation that, you know, Pastor Deb touched on it, is a congregation truly doing God's work. And we may not all be able to preach God's word as good as Pastor Deb, but we can all do good things. And there's a lot of people in this congregation doing good things for this community, and I think this the community sees us as a church with its doors open, not just for the Christians and the believers, but for everybody, and our youth programs are a good example of that. We have been blessed with Pastor Deb coming to this congregation. She's a hardworking, dedicated, great addition to this congregation, and we should all feel blessed for that. I'd like to say a special thanks to Marvin Bishop for all his lengthy years of service to this congregation as the treasurer. Marvin has expressed his desire to slowly retire, if you will. This congregation is going to be in need of a treasurer and going to be actively working at filling that position for Marv. He's agreed to stay involved until we can make that happen, but put that on your hearts and prayers. And another thing that's come to light to me kind of late in my term as president is I think this congregation could be served by allowing the president to serve an extended term, not necessarily about me, but we've had a lot of great leaders that I think there could be some good done by that leader staying in position for more than 1 year. The typical scenario here is you get on council, you serve a year, a leader may surface over that year, you become vice president the second year, and the vice president naturally, and rightfully so, becomes president the following year. So it really does take 3 years to get to that position or be ready for that position as president, but looking back now, there's just a lot of things that I see, and I'm sure a lot of the past presidents can contest to that, is there's some things you wish you would have done, and you've been involved, and you've got a working relationship with the pastor, and I think there's just some good could happen from a lot, and it's not going to be for everybody, but allowing that president position to be extended for a year upon approval of the council, and I'm encouraging some discussion about that throughout the next few months, and possibly a change in our constitution to allow that, so... With that, we'll move on. Next, we have approval of the committee and team reports. All the committee reports and team reports are in your handout there. You can take a second to flip through those. And if there's any questions, we'll get a committee liaison or leader to answer those. No, it's just ours. Pastor Deb and I have kind of started to have some conversation about it. It seems like there's no real standard for how congregations handle their terms, but no, it would just have to be language in our own constitution that would change.
I have one little question. It seems like every time we have a president, though, once they get off, they're done. For the year, when the year is up, they're exhausted.
Absolutely. We've had that discussion, and it wouldn't be necessarily something that is going to be pushed. It's just an option, and I just think we've had some great leaders that not very often in the committees or councils do you have the leader only sit there for 1 year, and I just know from being there it takes time. Even as a vice president, you're just not prepared for what you're going to be up against, and it takes time to build that working relationship and get to know people and things, and agreed, there's definitely going to be people that just don't want to do it or are mentally exhausted from a year, and so it's a good point, but really, I would just, go ahead.
Well, in a lot of organizations, they have what they call President Pro Tem, which really is not part of the leadership officially, mm-hmm. but they keep coming to the meetings, and they give guidance. That may be something you want to think about too. Mm-hmm. Is, I know from being a past president when I left the presidency, the new president, we had lots of conversations on the phone. It wasn't an official thing, but, you know, we talked a lot. So that may be something you want to think about, too, that he could keep on, you know, coming to meetings. And
yeah, and that's great conversation is...
change in that so they could serve 2 3-year terms, and then somebody could be president 2 years, still be there to help. I mean, and that doesn't mean people have to serve the second, but they could.
Right.
Yeah, right. And
isn't the president chosen by the
council?
Council.
All the positions are chosen by the council. So, yeah, all good points, and that's what it would take is just a little more conversation to figure out what the best logistics for that are. I believe our Constitution says you have to sit off a year before you can, yeah. So you do have to take a break. You can serve again at any point, but you do have to take a 1 year break. So just some food for thought. I think it, you know, it might not be the best thing for this year or last year or whatever. I just think it's a good option to have there that it could help, so. It is. It is definitely hard to prepare yourself for it. And every year is different, right? I mean, you know, for me, a couple months of the whole thing was really all around calling the new pastor. So I didn't even have a chance to work with Pastor Deb till, you know, March or whatever. And so every year is different, but I think it would be a viable option. Okay. Do we have any discussion about committee or team reports? Seeing none, we're looking for a motion from the floor to approve the committee and team reports.
So moved.
We have a motion and a second.
Alan.
Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion approved. Old business. Do we have any old business to discuss? I would think not, but well, with no old business, we're to the new business.
Wait, we're going to back up because we forgot to put in approval of the 2016 financial report.
It was on life.
Yeah, okay. You just didn't look at the screen.
Oh, I didn't look at the screen. I'm looking at this. Sorry.
Remember, that was one of the additions.
Yeah. So we're 2016 financial report. You can... Actually, we want to see this.
I have it on my screen.
Oh, there it is. No.
Okay. So you can see we have a...
I do only this one. You do that one.
We have a new format. Instead of just a blank, or instead of all the broken out numbers, we kind of have a new... Is it page 15? On page 15, you can see it. Yeah, a new pie chart available. You can see it's basically broken out into percentages of where our money goes. Did I say 16?
Went.
Oh.
Where our money went in 2016.
Yeah, where our money went in 2016. It gives you a little better idea of where it is instead of just numbers on a sheet. We can see what percentage of the money went where. And those are actual money spent. We're going to get into it a little bit later, but an item to me that sticks out is the capital improvements. That's actual money spent is... Oh, okay. So we got some points of interest. We've had great ministry poured out in this congregation. The giving is less than anticipated, so the income was less than planned. This congregation seems to be very good about stepping up when it's time to step up. So our giving dollar-wise, was less than what we anticipated, but we spent less. But a lot of that money came in by donated materials, donated time, and that's why our expenses are less than planned. So the giving is really still there, it just doesn't show up because it was given and unaccounted for, basically. I mean, we're going to get to it a little later and show all of where that money went, but that's why. Oh, it's up now. So, on the expenses were less than planned portion, the full-time pastor didn't start till March, so that's obviously some money that we didn't spend that we were planning for. Parsonage remains empty until March. Education, property, and benevolence expenses were less than planned. So those are some places where we plan to spend money that weren't. Administrative expenses were slightly more than planned due to the purchase of a laptop for the pastor. Worship and outreach expenses were more due to the cost of pulpit supply, pastors before Pastor Deb was called. So all stuff based around that 2 or 3 months where we didn't have a full-time pastor. So the capital improvements... Why does it not come up on that? Oh, okay. So the capital improvements, all made possible through work, offerings, and additional donations. And like I said, in the pie chart, those items aren't really accounted for. So the capital improvements is really bigger than that, but it's all through donation stuff. We had interior painting of the parsonage deck, parsonage floor covering, blinds in the parsonage, new concrete on the parsonage driveway, rock on the driveway, new eave troughs in the church, new millings in the church parking lot, new air conditioner in the pastor's office. Moving the pastor and the family, new water heater in the church bathroom, parking lot lights are working again. So these are all things that were donated time and money by this congregation. And that's a great thing. And I really think that that deserves an applaud for you. Any questions on the new format? One thing we're doing is this is our mission. In the past, we've always called it our budget. This is our mission. Especially difficult for people that are maybe that have ever done a family budget or business budgets. Churches are just different, and I've finally got my head around that, and Pastor Deb really spearheaded this whole thing, but we are the monies that come in are truly for a mission for this congregation, and that's what we're moving towards, and that's kind of was part of why we're changing the format. We want you guys to see it as our mission. How are we providing that mission, and what are we doing with those funds that come in? So any comments, suggestions, questions about it? And we do have a broken out treasures report if anybody would like to see one, or we have them in the back, kind of the old format. But so this is, I like it. It's good. It's easier to kind of understand where our money's going. Okay, with no, yeah, any questions?
Can I make a suggestion?
Yeah.
Yet we're short on what we're giving. So, and just let me get to the point. So the point being is, if there's any way in the annual report that you can account for these types of things. I know some people say, I don't want anything back from you for taxes or anything like that. But most people should be able to say it's about this much money. I mean, it'd just be interesting to know at the end of the year, these are the gifts that aren't accounted through the offering, but they're still gifts to the church. Yeah.
No, that's a great idea, and we would just have to make an effort. The council would have to make an effort to reach out to those people and just say, we're not asking for a receipt. Give us an idea of what you spent and account for that. It's a great idea.
I just have a comment. there's choice dollars that I can contribute that I didn't realize until I talked to our representatives. So I don't know if anybody else is aware of that, but I'm going to take my choice dollars and give them to the youth for their all their to help their expense and so forth. But that's something to consider, and I just thought I'd put that out for people because I wasn't quite aware of that until I talked to the Thriving people.
So look into that, and if you have choice dollars available, you can send them where you want to your... Right, and that could probably be something we could add in there somehow or account
and
for.
That is, but it is one of the committee reports.
Yeah.
Our mission. Yeah, but we can do, we absolutely can do kind of another total that includes those in-kind gifts and the mission of the months and those types of things as well. I'm just going to... If you're going to speak, I might bring the microphone to you so everybody can hear you better, as well as we are taping this so that those who could not be here today will be able to access it online, so then they can hear your questions or comments as well.
Any other?
I move approval.
So if there's no other discussion on the 2016 financial mission plan, Treasurer's report, we already have a motion to approve.
Second.
And a second.
Who's second?
Kevin. Kevin. We have a motion and a second. All in favor to approve?
Aye.
Motion approved. Oh, old business. We already talked about old business. We didn't have any. We'll move on. New business, which first item on the new business is approval of the 2017 financial plan, page 19. It's obviously, hit it one more time. It's going to look very similar to what you just saw. The increase is pretty much based around the additional pastoral costs. I mean, other than a few inflationary things amongst it all, it's basically $4,000 more than 2016, and it's based
on... Can I show? What I did is I kind of broke it down again into each of the ministries that we do, and to show you approximately, 13% of the Ministry of Administration, and where does our money go for that? We've got our secretary and all of the things that she does behind the scenes. Thank you, Peg. Including trying to keep this pastor in line, which she probably should get paid triple. Office and church supplies, gifts, postage, licensing fees, as it says in your book. Ministry of Property is approximately 18% or $21,000. Included in that is Kim's cleaning services each week, as well as our insurance, utilities, and maintenance. This is what our financial plan will cover. Our Ministry of Education. Yes.
Backing up to that one.
This one?
No, that one right there.
Yes.
Talk about the insurance. Did we project, if we go with that preschool, the insurance that we're going to have to pay for that, is that in there?
Yes. The insurance increase, if we decide to go with the preschool, will be $64 a year. So we're good. Well, it's not technically in there, but I'm not worried. $64. I'll write the check if we need to. But yes, we did look into that, though, Rod, so that's a great question. We did look into the insurance cost for the preschool, so yes.
I noticed that you've done a lot to the parsonage and the church in the last year.
The projects actually come out of capital improvements.
It's a little different than this.
But Marv will tell you why we needed to increase the Ministry of Property.
First off, his electric rates went up the 1st of January. And I don't know how much they're going up, but I put some extra in there. A second thing, a major item, was a lawnmower for the church property here. We need to come up with a new plan for caring for the lawn, whether that's buying a mower or hiring it done, probably one of those two options.
Part of it, Marv, is the council approved $1,000 to buy a mower. So that was part of that.
It's paid for. Yeah, it's to purchase. We set aside $1,000 to purchase a lawnmower if we determine to go to put towards the purchase of the lawnmower. Yep.
So it's a good point, though, that we did do a lot of work, capital improvement work, to the Parsons and the church this year. And the obvious point would be, okay, if we did that last year, why isn't that fund maybe lower? But it's a capital improvement fund, so it's a little different.
But this is actually out of our mission plan. We're not to the capital improvement fund yet. This is actually out of the mission plan. And that's what it is. It's a mission plan. It's our best guess. We'll see what happens as the year goes on. Ministry of Education is approximately 1% or about $1,100. Boy, we do a lot with that $1,100, let me tell you. Ministry of Worship and Outreach, this is worship stuff, but it is also outreach stuff like our dog night meals, our fellowship food, as well as our worship materials, devotions, and pulpit supply comes out of this one, is that right? Yes, and pulpit supply for 4 Sundays per year. Ministry of Word and Sacrament, yes, that is the largest portion of your budget, of your mission plan, is to have a full-time pastor. Yep, that is truth. That's part of what you get if you have a solo full-time pastor here. Ministry of Benevolence, we are setting aside 9 to 10% of our annual income, and that money is used to support the South Dakota Synod, the Hospitality Fund, Lutheran Social Services, Lutheran Campus Ministry, and Lutheran Outdoors in South Dakota. We did make some changes last year as to where those last three of our benevolences went. And part of what we did as a council is we sat down and said, what's the mission of this church, and how can our benevolence help to fund that mission? So because the majority of the mission of this congregation deals around education and children and families, we looked for sources that also helped families and children and education. So that's why we went with those to receive our benevolences. And then our mission of the month won't do it for those. They will do for other things, which is a great team effort. And then this is where our capital improvements are. And approximately 5% of the budget, of the mission plan, Jack has already referred to, is a little bit separate for capital improvements, but we needed to put that in, and that's set aside if there's any large improvements or church equipment. And I was wrong. I thought that's where the money for the riding lawnmower went, and I was wrong. It went in the property one, so ignore that last little part.
And it is down a little bit, but just like we talked before, the mission plan couldn't afford what we did to the parsonage and the church.
Okay, so Mickey, ask your question again. What? Because obviously we didn't get to what you were looking for.
Okay, the question was your Ministry of Property. You have increased it by almost $1,600.
Yes, and that's where I made the mistake on the PowerPoint. The Ministry of Property, $1,000 of that $1,600. We have set aside for the lawnmower, and the other $600 was due to, we know there's going to be an increase in utilities.
because electricity went up as of January 1st. And it's going to, and it could go up higher. So we wanted to have more in that area to hopefully cover what we're guessing the cost might be of the utilities. Does that help? Okay, because I want to make sure your question is answered. It did not. That's where I was wrong on my PowerPoint and my understanding. Kevin took your microphone.
Okay, any other discussion? No discussion? We're looking for a motion to approve the 2017 financial mission plan. We have a motion. And a second by Rodney. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Next item on the... Am I missing something here, Greg? Next item on new business is approval of the new mission statement. Okay. So we've actually done some work on this, mostly Pastor Deb, but we had a retreat amongst the council members to kind of help find a new mission statement. And you can see in your... on the board what we come up with. So we invite, encourage, educate, and empower all people to follow God and serve others. We, through a lot of discussion and research, and we believe this fits this congregation better, this church. So I'll...
If you look on the back... I don't know if this one's... Yeah. If you look on the back of your annual report, you will see... work that the congregation did about 10 years ago on our core values, our bedrock beliefs, our visions, and then the mission statement is on the bottom. And through conversations, I think most of this still pertains to who we are. They actually recommend that you do this work every 3 to 5 years, that you look at this again with your congregation. But I really felt that the mission statement was not really what this church was all about. When you go out and talk about your congregation, I want you to have a statement that you can memorize and that you can take out and you can be excited about and you can let people know this is who we are as a church. And so again, as Jack said, through a lot of work, I would offer up that we change our mission statement to the one that you see printed there and printed on the agenda in your inside cover.
So moved. No other discussion. We have a motion to approve the new mission statement and a second. Alan and motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Okay. Our next item on the agenda is approval of the use of the space in the church for the preschool. I'm going to let Pastor Deb, there is a flyer in your booklets there that kind of break it out. I'm going to let Pastor Deb talk about it. We've actually had a couple meetings of discussion about it with the council. Amongst the council, it's our general consensus that we are in favor of this. We do have Rex from the YMCA to answer some questions for us, and we'd like to just kind of open this up, but I'll let Pastor Deb take it from here.
Rex, do you want to just kind of offer a couple words? We'll open it up for others who have comments and questions. I know Connie would like to comment.
Maybe Rex, just kind of give us the basic scenario, what we're wanting to do.
Hold it close to your mouth.
Always like this.
Yes.
First off, let me say how excited it was. I pulled in the parking lot. There's no place to park. Holy cow! What a big group. So, I guess we've been kind of looking at this preschool thing in Hermosa for a couple years, and basically it evolved around our after-school program in Hermosa, and somewhat a little bit on my part, because we struggle to find staffing for the after-school program. So if we could find another position for a staff person, and that's on down the road, that we could have a better use of staff. But the bigger thing was that we wanted to be able to provide preschool education for children. I mean, studies show it that kids that hit preschool, have preschool, hit kindergarten, ready to go. You know, I think about the old days when I went to kindergarten. I mean, they were worried about keeping our hands off each other and everything else. And now the kids hit kindergarten and they're counting to 100 and they're doing their colors and everything else under the sun. So it's a whole different animal than what it used to be. So Nicole Weiss, my child care director, and I were over here a couple months ago, and we were just driving through town looking at different places and different sites. And being an old child care director myself, and Nicole being a child care director, we drove by and saw this big playground outside, and I said, oh, this has got promise. Walked in, and we stumbled into an old preschool teacher, and before you know it, we're into a major conversation about child care and preschool and the whole shoot match. So our desire is to set up a preschool in Hermosa. I mean, that's point blank and what it comes down to. And Nicole couldn't be here today. She's probably the one who should be talking about this whole thing because she understands a lot better than I do. But I'm here to answer questions. If there's questions that you have of me, of what the Y is looking at doing, please fire at me. And if I can't answer them, I'll get your answers and I'll get it back to Deb. So there you go.
Connie, did you want to speak?
I just want to say I've had, you know, a lot of impact from the preschool and Y programs in Custer. My children both went to the Y preschool and began their love of learning through that program. I was able to, as a kindergarten teacher, we worked very closely with the preschool staff. Any program we've adopted at school, if they've been able to adopt it at their preschool to support us, so those kids are more ready to come to kindergarten. And of course, as a kindergarten teacher, just knowing the importance of that early intervention has been so important. When Lois's son, Corbin, and his wife, Terry, were the directors of the program, they worked very strongly. Our school felt so strong about the program that when I taught half-day kindergarten, we had a space they could use, and they used it. And then when we no longer had space, they went to the Lutheran Church in Custer and then to various sites in Custer till they found a home. So it's been a very important part of the preschool and education system. It's been a partnership with us. Their teachers want to know what they can do to support us. We meet with them. And so as a parent, it was important to my kids as a teacher. It's been important to the children that enter my program, and it's been very valuable. I think it fits so well with the mission, as Jack talked about earlier, about education and about how our doors are open to the community. What a small investment to make in the future. Our daycare providers that have in-home daycares help us figure out a way that many of those children can go to the preschool in the mornings and go to other daycares in the afternoon too. So it's really a community thing there. So I look forward to being able to maybe be a partner in another community.
I don't want to read to you everything that's on the sheet, but questions.
Assuming you've talked to Lori over at the school, right?
And in conversation with Lori, what kind of response
are you getting from the parents?
I have not.
What kind of response are you getting from the parents in the community needing a preschool in our area?
I have not specifically talked to the parents. I've only talked to the educators. Lori and Jenny are very much. Jenny Nagelbauer is the kindergarten teacher here. Lori Enright is the principal at the school.
And I've had several conversations with them. Both of them are very much to support Well, I know they have a type of preschool program at the school right now, if most of you don't know. Alex is involved with it.
Only for children
that have special needs. Yes. Yeah, they have to be qualified. They have to have a developmental problem. But my question is on your paper, you're stating that any parent that enrolls your kid in a preschool going to the church is going to have a fee. And that's a pretty hefty fee. Are we planning on offsetting that, or is that going to be completely on the parents? Because that's a big deterrent.
The fee is totally on, is the running of the preschool itself is totally the why. Our church is just the space. One of the things that I've had conversations about with Jenny and with Lori and with somebody else who I can't think of right now that brought that same concern is the possibility of doing some fundraising to have a preschool scholarship monies available, and it would be some community fundraising to have preschool money scholarship monies available. Crystal, that's what it was. You brought it up first. I'm like, there was somebody else.
Hey, Rex, can we clarify that this program would not affect what Hermosa is doing with their special needs kids at all? Is that true?
That's the way I understand it. Yeah, we are not looking to offset anything what the school's doing right now. I mean, the school's got their program, and
you wouldn't be in a position to take special need kids, or not. Don't know that answer.
You know, my gut feeling on that is no, we wouldn't be able to do that, Jack. Our situation is such that I can't take on a program that I have to subsidize in Hermosa. Okay, so the fee that you're talking about essentially would be, the fee would cost to run the program. Right now, we hadn't built in for the insurance costs even, but I mean, if that came down to it that we needed to pay for the insurance costs, we'd come up with that. But the fact of the matter is, you know, the fees are set so that we can pay staff and we can pay for program supplies and everything we need to do in order to run the program. And it's as close to the edge as we can possibly be so that we don't set up a situation where parents are having difficulty with that sort of thing. So,
but just a sec. Just to clarify, though, the church is not funding. But it's solely on the parents or however.
I understand. My curiosity is the interest in the community because we do have a home daycare that provides a very good preschool program to kids in daycare now. And a lot of parents get in with her because of the preschool program that she runs. And she certified teaches and she has fees for that. There is a program at the school that has, for qualified kids, a preschool program. Now, outside of those two programs, how much interest is there really in the community to have a separate preschool program that they're going to have to pay a fee for that the community may not be able to
sustain?
And are we going to, you know, yes, providing the space, and I understand a small amount of insurance, but it's still something that we're going to have to be prepared for to have in our church for maybe a few kids at best.
And that's a good point. I mean, we don't want to sugarcoat it. I mean, it we have had enough discussion that the council as a whole is in favor of it. I think just like it's been brought up, it's another great outreach for Community Lutheran Church to help the community in a need. And but the truth of it is, there is going to be spaces in our church that's going to be occupied for a half a day, 4 days a week. Outside the insurance, the minimal insurance costs, you know, they're probably going to be a little bit increase in electricity. Might be an increase in the water bill, probably not. But so, yeah, we want everybody to be fully informed. And I think it's a good thing. I don't really and the other thing is we talked about, you know, we're going to sign this up 1 year at a time. If we get in here for a year and, hey, this is not our thing, it didn't fit, there's too much conflict, it's creating a conflict with the community or the parents or whatever, then it can go away. I mean, it's not a 5-year commitment, so.
I would think, too, with the interest from the community as far as that goes, we haven't, as a congregation, even approved that we're interested in doing this yet. So it's hard to go to the people of the community and ask if they're interested if we're not going to have it.
But I guess that's their job too. But I mean, that's the way I feel about your question is.
There had been interest. Because before the school got the preschool program set up, I would have loved to have one in the community, but now my son's in the preschool program, so I'm okay with that.
Well, I think Rex is probably could talk to how much interest. I mean, I would think you wouldn't be here if there wasn't some interest, but.
You know, I don't know how much interest there is, and you bring up a great point. We are prospecting, for lack of a better way of putting it. I mean, if there's a need for a program, we're here. But the last thing I want to do is look like I'm coming in on my big white horse to save the day. I mean, if there's a need for a program, we're here to provide it. If there isn't a need for it, if this child care provider has got a program going on and we don't get the registration, well, we'll step back and we'll get out of the way. But the fact of the matter is, I don't want to get into a situation where we're running a program that's competing or conflicting with anybody else in the community. I mean, I've been in Custer for about 8 years now, and that's the one thing that I've done that I have. We don't compete with people. I mean, if somebody else wants to run something, we'll step out of the way. That's all there is to it, because too small communities. I mean, if you start looking at, if you're in Rapid City, you might be able to run a preschool and not worry about what else is going on. But the last thing I want to do is start creating a in a community and building bridges or building walls.
Yeah. So today we're not approving a preschool. What we're doing, we're asking, is to approve allowing the YMCA to use our space if they have enough interest and it fits.
Statement made that there would be no changes made to the church itself. Who made that determination? Because you're talking about housing 20 preschool kids in a basement that needs fire exits. It needs to meet certain standards, so you don't.
Preschools do not have a state standard that they have to meet. And so it was Rex and myself and Nicole who walked through and said we do not need to make structural changes to this place.
Okay, so we can get that in writing from the state or whoever determines in the county of Custer that it is not needed in writing.
The difference, Rodney, and that's a great point to bring up, is licensed versus non-licensed. If we were going to set up a licensed childcare situation in the church, then we get into all those jumps and hoops and everything else we have to comply with. But since it's going to be a non-licensed child preschool, then we don't have to worry about the extra police.
I'm not even looking at the licensed, non-licensed. I'm looking at the safety of the children that are going to be housed.
When we added to the new fellowship hall downstairs, that question came up too. I got the Rapid City Fire Inspector out here to look over the situation, and he said we had adequate egress options. Yeah.
It's all good. It's all good discussion. We want to make a good, informed decision here, and it's great discussion. So.
That was brought up earlier, maybe at this point in time we just say move forward with the discussion with the YMCA, but ask that the YMCA come back with, you know, we have the need, the desire, etc. I think you tried to say it before, is that today we're not going in to say tomorrow we're going to open our doors tomorrow. There's a whole thing with YMCA that needs to happen, and discussions and contracts and all that, but I'm assuming today all you're asking the congregation is, do we move forward?
Yeah. Do we move... I got this one now. Yeah, but do we... They need to know that they have a space available, you know, in the near future, so that they can continue to explore. So, yeah, well,
it's tough to have a discussion with the
surrounding Hermosa without knowing that they have space.
Right. Without having inexpensive or someone to provide a free facility, it's not even an option. So
I would allow them. I would make a motion to allow them to have the building and to go ahead and look forward to the next step.
Is there a way that we can approve this, but the final approval with the council in case something comes up?
Yeah, probably. I guess we would have to present the motion to approve the space upon council approval of the preschool or something of that nature. But yeah, I think that's an option. If that's what everybody's a little more comfortable with, Chick?
It mentions the snow removal. Who is funding that snow removal?
It would just be part of our plan. We have kind of a new snow removal mission, if you will, in the works right now. It would just be our normal snow removal, which we fund or volunteer help or whatever, but it would just be part of our thing. But it would have to be a little more diligent, obviously. I mean, you know, where it's very important to have it open for Sunday morning, now it's pretty important to have it open by 8 o'clock Monday morning. So, yeah, for sure, that's another talking point, which we've kind of hit on that. And Kevin's kind of leading the snow removal effort, and we have a plan.
I second Lois's motion to allow them to use the space if they find that there is a need. And
so, if I'm correct here, we have a motion on the floor to... Okay, Richard's going to have a little more discussion.
Can I make a suggestion to Lois they remove their motion that's on the floor and run with the motion instead that Jack said, where basically we're giving the council the permission to work with the YMCA at this point in time. So in essence, we're giving the council, they have the say to say yay or nay to YMCA.
Lois?
That's what we've been trying to say.
Okay, I think... So what we're looking for is a motion from the floor to approve the council's authority to work with the YMCA to provide a space.
I so move.
Okay. So we have a motion. Huh? Well, I think the support of the congregation will be our yays and nays here in a second, however.
Okay, so here is what I'm hearing the motion to be. The congregation approves working with the YMCA and partnering and offering a space upon, let me start that again. Give me just a second. Yeah, so just a second, okay? It's a second. We move to give authority to the church council to partner with the YMCA to provide a space for a preschool if a need is found.
Okay,
did you get that?
No.
We move...
It's recorded.
We move.
Yes, it is recorded. We'll get it out. We move to give authority to the church council to partner with the YMCA to provide a space for a preschool in Hermosa if the need is found.
To provide a space for...
If it is found to have a need.
Yeah, if the need is found. If it is found to have a need. If it is found to have a need.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Now, we have ballots. Richard. We have ballots for this, and we are going to hand them out, and it's a yes or no vote. Kevin's going to hand them out, some pencils. Thank you, Rex, for taking some time out of your day and answering questions.
Thank you.
Nope. Yeah, we want to do the... Yeah.
Can I vote for Jay?
You go with what she says, so she needs to...
No, I cannot vote for Jay.
What else do we got? What's next?
Okay.
You're too slow.
He has to be in the meeting. He's providing childcare.
Pastor, can I talk about the council member?
Please do.
While we're filling out and collecting those ballots, the next item on the agenda is to elect two new council members. We have two empty seats to fill, and historically we've had an alternate. We have two people on the ballot right now, which would fill those two empty seats. We're looking for any nominations from the floor for additional council people we could vote on.
I'd like to offer myself as an alternate for the council.
Can we accept just...
Mike has graciously offered himself for an alternate, so here's the deal. You're going to get a ballot. We're going to write Mike Boschnagel's name in it. We cannot actually vote for him as an alternate. He has to get third place. So you get to vote for two. So if you would vote for the other two and somebody in here vote for Mike, then he'll get third place and he'll be the alternate.
I just make the suggestion that Mike writes his own name in since he knows how to spell
it. I'll even spell it for you. Mike could write his own name in and vote for himself, and then he would be the alternate. We just can't, by constitution law, vote for the alternate. But if that's the position that you would like, we want to honor that, and thank you.
So do we have any other nominations from the floor for church council? So when... We have a motion and a second... Oh, no, there's more than one. We have Wyon.
We have a ballot, but it's not in the...
It's not in the book because the book hasn't been printed.
Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. It got out of hand. Wyon, Leonard and Gloria Olowski are our two candidates on the ballot. When you get your ballot, please write in Mike's name and vote for two. And if you want to vote for Mike on council, you think he'd be better than the other candidates, you're welcome to do that. We're not here to direct you on how to vote. That would be collusion or something crazy. So, right, you don't have to try to spell Mike's last name unless you're courageous. Yeah, you can spend that. So we'll hand out ballots. Please write Mike's name in. Vote for two. You
do not have to write Mike's name in.
No kidding. Yes,
you should write Mike's name in. But just vote for two.
His first name is acceptable.
Okay, before we do that, I'm going to, before we do that, we have a count on our vote for the preschool per the motion. We have 43 yays and one nay. So the motion is approved.
Lyle had surgery, so she's still at home with ice packs on her face.
And I'm sure you all know Wyone, and she served as our alternate during the last term. She's a great addition to the council. Pastor, so let's, Wyone's not here. Like I said, she comes, she's been to numerous of the meetings. She's a great addition. So we'll introduce Gloria. Oh, there you are. So, Gloria is on our ballot. That's fine. So, would you like to get up and give your nominate your nothing? Nothing. No speech? Hey, hold on. We have a campaign speech here from her. Well, okay, we also have a speech for Mike, unless he would like to give his own, but Lois would like to say a few words.
She doesn't want to.
Anyway.
While we're counting ballots, is there any additional business that anyone feels like we need to talk about?
I got a question.
Okay. Yeah, they're actually, we post the minutes downstairs, but would you like something, you mean like part of the newsletter? Okay, yeah, no, for sure. Until we get that in motion, they are posted downstairs on the bulletin board, but that's a great idea. Yep, it's a great idea. Pastor Deb's all over it, I can tell.
What I do want to warn you though is I will make sure something is sent out, notes. But they are unofficial minutes because we do not approve the minutes until the next monthly meeting, okay? So I have no problem sending out some notes, but they are unofficial, okay? I just want that to be heard. And absolutely, we can do that. Absolutely.
I think it would be nice to put that in there, too, for people that are...
Yes, absolutely.
These are unofficial, they're not...
Yep, absolutely. Non-approved. Absolutely. Absolutely, we can do that. It's a good idea.
I think it's a great way to drive people to the website.
Yes, as long as somebody gets it posted there that's not me because I haven't learned how to do that yet.
Okay, any other business? Someone like to talk about? Thanks, Dan. Mars got something.
As mentioned earlier, I've got a dozen copies of a detailed financial report and budget here. If you would like to look at more figures, and if that's not enough, I can make some more, but I didn't want to oversupply. Also, I've got the offering statements for the first half of the alphabet up through part of the ends. If you want to pick that up afterwards and save us a stamp of mail and amount. Thank you.
Okay, if there's no new business while we're still counting ballots, I'm going to turn it over to Greg for announcements and recognitions.
I just was wanting or was told what I'm doing, and wanted to thank Jack and Crystal for their time on the council. They've both done a great job. Jack's been an outstanding president and got to do a lot with the last few years, or last year. And I see Bob Tesh snuck out on us, but we also wanted to thank Bob for all of his years of mowing and helping keep the church beautiful. And I guess he already thanked Marv, but Marv was wanting to step down, and we just wanted to thank him for all he's done for the church with chocolate, like usual.
I would like to give Pastor Deb a small gift, since we kind of forgot about her at Christmas time and her birthday, and I got reminded that men aren't really very good at that kind of stuff. So we have a little special gift for you for all your...
Thank you very much.
And it looks like the results are in. Well, Mike, you're more popular than you thought, but council people filling the empty positions are Wyone, Gloria, and Mike as the alternate. So before we adjourn, the council will have a short meeting before they get to go eat chili in Pastor Deb's office. So with that, I will adjourn the... We have a motion to adjourn. A second. All in favor to adjourn the annual meeting. Motion carries. So we're going to stand up, say the Lord's Prayer, and we'll be gone. So the new council members, don't forget, you got to come to the meeting.
Us.